Hello and welcome, dear viewer. Do you ever wonder how computers go from this to this? In other words, what happens when a computer boots? I don't have a good introduction, so let's just look at what needs to happen for an operating system to come together and boot on a modern PC. So we won't talk about operating system fundamentals, but I think it's good to look at a practical example, especially Serenity as a very understandable example. And please note that I have to simplify. A lot. First of all, we'll have to understand how all the source files fit together into the build, which means that we're talking about build systems. In Serenity, there are basically three layers. At the top level, the Serenity.sh script makes sure that the correct arguments are passed to the correct commands, that the correct commands are executed in the first place, and so on. Then the actual core build system is CMake. CMake is very good at finding source and header files and fitting them together, at resolving dependencies and receiving specialized commands for our own subtasks. For example, we need to generate some C++ files from other files like IPC or IDL definitions. Most of these tasks are run by Serenity's own C++ executables that are written in normal Serenity C++ and compiled on the host before being run in the build process. We'll get to that in a moment. What CMake just does is it runs a few high-level tasks like downloading necessary databases, but after that it just generates build commands for a lower level, as CMake itself doesn't actually run the build itself. The build commands can be generated for multiple lower build systems, but we usually use Ninja. Ninja basically just receives a list of approximately 4,500 build commands with low-level dependencies, and then it figures out in which order to run the build so that as much as possible can be done in parallel. Most of your time is spent looking at this build progress line that Ninja outputs. But Ninja also assembles all the pieces together and creates the files that emulators or hardware need. Executing the emulator is actually done by a subscript of serenity.sh, run.sh. But what does building actually entail? Well, in Serenity, first of all, there's LAGOM and SuperBuild. These two are parts of the system, mostly small executables, some libraries and AK, that are built for the host, not for Serenity itself. As I said beforehand, some parts of the build process are run in Serenity code itself, so what we do first is run the SuperBuild, which just compiles the necessary parts into host executables, and then run the main build, which involves running these host executables. Full LAGOM builds even more libraries and executables for the host. For example, you can use Serenity's JavaScript implementation on your own computer by compiling libjs and the JS REPL with LAGOM. The main build can now be thought of as three main parts. First, there's the libraries. These are built for the userland applications and they're compiled into shared objects. These shared objects, which are some form of ELF dynamically linked library, later end up in Serenity itself. If you open /user/lib, you'll see the library shared objects. Second, there's userland applications. These are compiled into dynamically linked ELF executables that refer back to the libraries, and they're placed in the /bin folder. At startup, the applications get all the library code put into their program memory, so that they can interact with the library normally. The programmer doesn't have to worry about it, we just need to tell CMake in the build files to have the library as a dependency. Also, remember that by applications I mean basically all things in these directories. The main difference here is the purpose of the application. Also, the utilities are super small applications that only have one main file, which means that we use a common build script for all of them. Thirdly, there's the kernel. Kernels are always bound by the hardware into a specific structure, so that's why this is a giant statically compiled binary in a multi-boot bootable form. So when we run Serenity, what happens? In QEMU, which is a hardware accelerated emulator we use, we run Serenity by giving the emulator two files, the kernel image and the drive image. As I said, the kernel image is an ELF-like multi-boot compatible binary. Multi-boot, a term I've now used twice without explanation, is a standard for bootloaders. This means that by having magic bits in specific locations in our binary, the multiboot header, a multiboot compatible bootloader like grub or qemu's ipxe, can load the kernel image or parts of it into memory, set up a frame buffer, set up some initial memory configuration, and initialize some other hardware we need early on. In qemu, conveniently, we don't have to have the kernel image somewhere on a virtual disk, we can just pass it directly. The drive image is just an image of an ext2 partition that contains Serenity's root file system, including all the applications and libraries we compiled before. If you look into the build/root folder, you can see all the files that are later combined into an ext2 image by external tools in the build process. When qemu, our virtual computer, starts up, the first thing it does, as I've said, is run the bootloader, which would probably be grub on a real system. From there, we first load the pre-kernel. The job of this system bootloader is just to load the kernel image from its ELF wherever possible in memory. Then the kernel is executed, more specifically, we jump into this specific location in memory. We now progress with initializing things, and the goal for now is to get multitasking working. The reason is that we're still just executing one thread on one CPU in supervisor mode, but for a proper multitasking operating system, we need the concept of threads and a scheduler even for kernel level work. So what we do is initialize scheduler required hardware like interrupts, timer, ACPI, and device management, and then bring up the scheduler as quickly as possible. This is followed by the last action of this single task code, startup init stage 2. This kernel thread, as the name implies, is stage 2 of the initialization, and it picks up from stage 1 to initialize all the hardware that we need, which includes starting up bus systems, detecting devices and initializing drivers, and starting up other processors. Finally, we have reached the point of being able to run user threads and processes. One of the last things that init stage 2 does is it spawns the user space init process. From the perspective of the kernel, all initialization tasks are done, and the user space init process is responsible for bringing up the rest of the system. Depending on what mode you booted Serenity in, there's a number of programs that can be the init process, but let's assume you didn't do anything special. In that case, the init process is system server. It's very comparable to systemd or the traditional Unix init, if you know about those. Remember that system server runs as a normal user space program, just as the root user, so it has access to all the high-level niceties like dynamic linking to userland libraries. The very first thing that system server does is it prepares the file system, which involves creating a bunch of symlinks in the synthetic file systems and setting up their ownership, as well as actually mounting all the real drives so that other processes can start up. Because that's exactly system server's job. It starts up processes according to systemserver.ini. There's actually two system servers, this one's for the entire system and another one for individual users. Both of these mainly boot up other services that are required for the system to work, about 20 to 30 at the moment. For example, Windows Server actually gives you the GUI, while Login Server allows you to log in with the user. Request server for executing requests over common protocols, Crash Daemon for handling crashing processes, or even just Chess Engine for playing chess. That one, like web content and a bunch of others, are special services only started on demand by system server, and you can read more in the system server configuration man page. At this point, we have a fully working operating system. And just to give you an idea of timescales, on my emulator, it takes about 10 seconds for the kernel image to be loaded, about 1 or 2 seconds until multitasking, and another 2 or so seconds for all services to start. Now, there's a bunch of further topics that are important to understanding how an operating system functions. How do we make sure that every program can run at some point? How do we communicate with the kernel? How do the file systems work? How do processes communicate with each other? What happens when a process starts up? These are all outside of what I wanted to discuss today. The idea was a general overview over how operating systems start up and get into a usable state, coupled to the well-understandable example of SerenityOS. Anything else Andreas has probably already talked about. So until next time, Goodbye.